We all have theme songs today. I got a little worried because when Judy first got up, they played Leaving on a Midnight Train to Georgia, and I didn't know what that pretended. And then when she finally got up, they were playing Heat Wave, so it makes total sense now. I want to thank Judy, and I want to thank Christiane for having me here today. It's truly an honor to see all you guys out here who do nature's work. I am humbled. We really need what you guys do. We really do. Because, And my small contribution it pales. So I'm here to talk about environmental education, a force for the future. We have four incredible panelists who will be up here. Here, let me start off by throwing this up. Let's see if that goes up. It doesn't seem to be working. There it, oop. No, that's backwards. Let's see if it goes this time. No, it's going backwards. Let's try if I go backwards and see what, yeah, look at that. I think we're going forward. Let's see, we'll go from there. Okay, good, we'll start with that. We get rid of the 40th anniversary, that's what we'll worry about it. Anyway, so in order to speak about the future, I wanted to talk a little bit about the past. And for me, I've been working at Disney now for 25 years. I've been producing animated films, and as of the last four, been working on the Disneynature label. Before that, I worked in nonprofit theater. So all of you who are in the nonprofit world, I can empathize with you. I know what that's about. Primarily in play development. That was my kind of gig back in the theater days. And then before that, I was being educated. And I can tell you that I would not have had my future had it not been for the fact that I had this amazing education. And so I believe in education, and I totally believe that education is the future. And I believe that each one of you can individually touch people the way that I can look back at five teachers in my lifetime that somehow affected my life and pushed me forward. So hands up to you guys. I'm so proud of you. I also believe that you guys should be given the tools to help inspire the environmental leaders and the stewards for tomorrow, because without them, we're really sunk. I'm a storyteller, and to be more specific, I'm a collaborative storyteller. I believe that stories bind us together as a people. I believe that stories educate us. I believe stories enlighten us. And I believe that stories can change us for the better. One might say I'm evangelical about stories, but the Westboro Baptist Church was here yesterday. But they're really more apocalyptic, so that's it. I feel really fortunate in my career in theater and film and animation that I have been able to give back a little bit. I taught for about 8 years in my life. And I continue to try and reach out into arts institutions because that's really what my background has been. I'm really proud of the work that Walt Disney does for both in terms of in the environment and conservation. It's really impressive, and I'm very happy to now be working with there it is. Are you trying to get the thing off there? I keep looking at myself, and it's unnerving. I actually realized when I usually trim this before I go and speak, but you have me in full peacock mode today. Anyway, I'm so proud of what Disney Nature does in terms of its outreach, in terms of its educational component, in terms of each film has its own educational component that goes out into the world. And this is really a legacy that goes back to the days of Walt Disney himself. And those of you who are of a certain age, and you know who you are if you are of that age, you'll remember that Walt's true life adventures were something pretty extraordinary and probably inspired millions of people to care about nature and to really start caring about the planet that we live on. Disneynature actually continues that legacy. We've been going now for 10 years. And we're sharing remarkable stories that hopefully touch the hearts of people and really make them think about this incredible world that we live in. About 4 years ago, when I finished Big Hero 6, I was asked if I would be interested in coming on and helping out with a film that was in production in Disneynature called Born in China. And I thought, yeah, that would be great to tell a story about an area of the world where probably a handful of people in the world will ever get to go, the Qinghai Plateau, which is 14 to 17,000 feet high, see animals that, you know, who are known as the ghost leopards, the snow leopards in the mountains. I thought this would be great. And then you add to that, I was going to get a chance to work with some of the greatest nature photographers and cinematographers in the world. And on top of that, I got to work with an amazing director by the name of Lu Chuan, who is a Chinese director who had never done a documentary to that point, nor had I. And I had seen his films and was blown away and knew that this guy was a storyteller. So I jumped in, and I jumped in feet first. Little did I know that 5 weeks later that I would become one of the producers on the project, because Chuan and I really found a common passion in storytelling. And we found that our approach to story and crafting story was incredibly similar. In a way, Chuan and I had kind of a story bromance. We were joined at the hip, figuratively. He would be in Beijing and I would be in Burbank, or he would be in Bristol, England, where we did a majority of the editing, and I would be in I'm always in Burbank, so that's the problem. We would, you know, we just had an amazing trust, an amazing communication, and this mutual respect. And I think the thing that really blows me away, let's see if this actually changes. No, it's going backwards. There it is. All right, I should have that slide up, I'm sorry. The thing that really blows me away is that it just further confirmed, and I didn't mention this earlier, that I believe that story can transcend borders and cultures. It's the thing that I've learned in animation, and it's the thing that I learned in nature filmmaking. Born in China actually turned out to be the largest documentary ever in China by three times. There had never been a documentary on the big screen that had achieved what it achieved. So it was really great, and it actually helped start an environmental movement and a discussion in China. So I'm very, very proud of that. Anyway, this started me down a path, and we'll go back to this slide. Is it going? Yes, good. It may have gone backwards, but we'll find out later. It started me down a path where, in addition to my animation work, I am now producing three Disney nature projects, one of which I will share with you in a little bit. But it's been really great. But we're here to talk about the force of a force for the future. And I want to get to that tout de suite, as we say in France. The format of the panel today is going to be a series of flash discussions. Each of the participants that are coming up have been asked to put together about a 9-minute presentation, and they're going to be talking about their work and how it relates to the future. Now, I've been doing a lot of research this last week, and then I got to meet the three of my panelists last night, and you're in for a treat. They really are brilliant, and I can't wait to see this. So let us start with, and I'll be back afterwards, after the four speakers, and I'll show you a little bit of video, just to have some fun. So let's see if this changes. No, I'm going to go backwards again. Here we go. Are we back on forward? There we go. There she is, ladies and gentlemen. Our first speaker is Jane Wei Skillern. She is a senior fellow at the Haas School of Business at the University of California in Berkeley. She has served on the faculty of the Stanford Graduate School of Business, the Harvard Business School, and the London Business School. And coincidentally, those were all my fallback schools. So, she is the author and the co-author of dozens of Harvard Business School studies, books and chapters, journals, and she is the lead author of a case study called Entrepreneurship in the Social Sector, which I think is what she's going to talk about now to a degree. So ladies and gentlemen, Jane Way Skillern.
Everybody, it's wonderful to be here with you all today. And that was Stand By Me. We're playing Name That Tune. So that is the theme of my remarks today. Thank you, Roy, for that very gracious introduction. I wanted to just start with a brief survey. I know it's rather early, and I thought we'd have some fun by doing the survey. To answer the survey, I'm going to ask you to please stand up. And then stay standing, and then I'll ask you. So, just after I ask the question, instead of raising hands, thank you. You are all alert. I know you had coffee today. So I'll ask the questions, and instead of raising your hands, we're going to just get some energy going in the room and ask you to please stand up and stay standing in response to my questions. So the question I'd like to start with is, if you're involved in some type of collaboration, any type, whether it's within your organization, across departments, across organizations, across sectors. Okay, so everybody just kind of look around and get a lay of the land here, okay? So your collaborations can be any form. They don't have to be as risky as what you see here. So please stay standing, and I want to now ask you, if your collaborations feel something like this, to please take a seat. Anybody? I see a few people sitting down. And you did make sure your partners are not in the room when you sat down, right? Okay, all right. So, wow, you guys are all pretty good at this. So my next question is, if your collaborations feel like this, they're going all right, but they could be better, they could be worse, but they're okay. Please take a seat if you feel like your collaborations are okay. Oh my gosh, you are a phenomenal group of people. I have never seen this many people standing. So then the rest of you, I'm guessing, unless you weren't listening, and if you're still standing, this is how your collaborations leave you feeling. If that's true, stay standing, because I'd love to just have everybody take a look around. These are the folks that you should all be speaking to at cocktail hour and reaching out to and finding out what are you doing right. Because I can tell you, I've done this survey in so many different groups. I have never had more than 10 people standing. I'm not kidding. And this is just amazing. So look around. These are the people you should single out when you can. Thank you for staying standing and all of your participation in this survey. And the reason why I asked, first of all, is because I wanted to highlight the fact that it doesn't work so well with this group because you're already so good at collaboration. But I wanted to highlight the fact that there's virtually everybody's involved in some collaboration or another. But there's often, in typical groups, you are far from typical, in typical groups, there's a huge gap between our aspirations for collaboration and what we can achieve and what's actually achieved. Now, you're such an unusual group. Half of you were still standing and smiling and are fabulous at leading and thriving collaborations. So you've already seen the future. In fact, my job is done. If Judy would allow me to, I should sit down and have you all come up and talk about what you're doing. But I don't want to get in trouble for not doing my job, so I'm going to stay up here for the 9 minutes that I'm allotted. So anyway, I highlight that first to highlight this gap between our aspirations for collaboration and what so often plays out when we start getting into the nuts and bolts of executing in collaboration. But at the same time, I wanted to highlight the fact that there is tremendous expertise in the room, in your communities, that many of you already know how to catalyze and lead by example and really make things happen at a macro level, not just at an organizational level or functional level. So I start with that in large part to highlight the reason why I want to share my research with you, because for the last 18 or so years, I have been studying This is me sitting up in an ivory tower. I have been studying networked organizations, organizations that have worked through very deliberate strategies of working with and through other organizations. So they're not thinking of their organization as a primary vehicle for change, building programs, expanding programs, building organizational infrastructure. What they have been doing is really investing in external networks to build the field. Now, clearly many of you have already had experience with that. But over this 18 years of studying these organizations, and I can show you what I've learned is not from sitting alone in my office, but really getting out into the field and talking to people who have been working across a range of different issue areas, everything from climate change to environmental conservation to microfinance, economic development, international development, education, you name it. I've looked at all different types of sectors and all different types of organizations, both large and small. Some foundations, prominent foundations, other very small grassroots organizations. And the lessons that come out across all of these leading organizations are a simple set of principles that are actually practiced probably by many of you in the room. So the four principles are, in a nutshell, all of these organizations and the leaders and the networks that they're a part of live and breathe these principles. The first is a focus on mission first rather than organization. The second is an emphasis on trust rather than control. Even if there are formal contracts, even if there are MOUs, the key thing that holds these collaborations together and makes them hum is the fact that there is a strong degree of trust amongst the participants involved. The third is an emphasis on humility. You all know probably now in the collaborations that you've been engaged in, there is never a smartest person in the room. There is never. No matter what skills, resources you bring to the table, there are tremendous assets and capacities that are in your peers and partners. And so it doesn't matter who brings the most money to the table, it doesn't matter who has the most prominent brand name, humility is an absolute must because we know for the problems we face as the human race, and all of Earth, for that matter, there is never going to be one silver bullet solution. So humility is of utmost importance. And then finally, the leaders in these networks strive to build constellations rather than stars. They're not trying to necessarily be that brightest star out there, but rather say, how do I engage and mobilize others in order to build that beautiful constellation? And it's only there where we have the full picture. So that, in a nutshell, is the four principles. This is a simple version. And the only challenging thing is, of course, that all of the underlying things that I see over and over again in all of my research, those are what are critical for networks to succeed. But unfortunately, the environment that we work in philanthropy and social impact work, rewards the exact opposite. It rewards organization success, big infrastructure. We reward or manage through top-down controls, systems, performance metrics, kind of try to force people to do or organizations to do what they wouldn't otherwise want to do. There's a huge emphasis on kind of out-competing your competition, building up your brand, self-promoting like crazy. And then this emphasis on we need to be the market leader, we need to be the stars. But I do know, I can assure you, what I have seen time and time again is that the things that are underlined matter far more than the things that we're currently rewarding in our fields. So I want to just close with a few thoughts with, if you hear, learn nothing else from what I've talked about, if you can just remember this graphic, what I'm talking about is the future is going to require much less of this and much more of that. And then since I started with a question or a series of questions, I thought I'd leave with a few questions. If you take these four leadership principles, I'd like to ask you to think, how can network leadership help you to achieve your goals? And then I leave you just with one last quote, which is, it's amazing what you can accomplish if you don't care who gets the credit. So thank you so much for your remarks. And then if you want more information, I've got a website and you can reach out, send me an email. I'd love to engage with you and talk with you more about how you're leading through networks and encourage you and support you in any way that I can. Thank you so much.
That's great. I particularly like the sentiment about humility, because humility really keeps you in check. Even in producing, I find if you're humble and you build trust. I like to think of myself as the king of humility, actually. So. Anyway. Can we, Rob, I'm going to ask you to do that. I was holding that thing upside down. That's why I was having so much trouble. So much for being the king of humble. Our next speaker is Shaun Martin. And Shaun is a senior director for climate change, adaptation, and resilience at the World Wildlife Fund. I'm a big fan of the World Wildlife Fund. We were partnered on Born in China, and the work that they do is outstanding. Shaun has more than 25 years of experience in capacity building, training, and leadership development. In his current role, he is helping influence policy and practice by bringing climate change dimensions to the field of conservation and sustainable development. This is what I'm really impressed with. He has designed and developed and delivered training on climate change and its adaptation to more than 1,500 people worldwide, from all the way from Washington, D.C. Ladies and gentlemen, Shaun Martin.
Everybody, I'm Shaun Martin from World Wildlife Fund, and I am here to talk to you about resilience, whatever that means. And the future is very important to me because I plan to spend the rest of my life there. Are you with me? All right. So Jane ended with a quote from Harry Truman. I'd like to begin with two quotes. And the first comes from Benjamin Franklin. And he said, by failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. Think about it a minute. Because his modern day successor, Mike Tyson, pretty much said the same thing. Everybody has a plan until they get hit. Now, why are these important to resilience, and particularly for conservation? It's because we are planning for a future that's very different than anything we've ever experienced. And we're not fully taking into consideration, particularly climate change and how that is shaping our future. And if we're not planning for that, we are preparing to fail. All right, no more laughter, here we go. All right, so why is everybody talking about resilience all of a sudden? To prepare for this talk last week, I used Google News search to search on resilience, and I came up with these. These are on the first page. Resilient Northampton, what are they? Holds off West Springfield, 9-6. Go Northampton, you're resilient. Make your home greener. Green is just not enough. It has to be resilient. Girls have to be resilient. Monetary unions have to be resilient. What is going on here? Everybody is talking about resilience. Do you all know what resilience means? Of course you do. But if I asked each of you to write a definition for me, you would all say something different. So do these people, all right? So I think, and I'm pretty sure of this, one reason why we're obsessed with resilience right now is because of this. The number and intensity of weather-related disasters are increasing, often with this footprint of climate change on them. And we've just, this week, unfortunately, the Florida Panhandle was hit by Hurricane Michael. It's normal for us to talk about how are we going to recover from this. And so this dialogue has begun and it's almost spun out of control. Everybody's talking about resilience. I kind of want to focus on what it means for the future of conservation. So if you're a conservationist, climate change is particularly worrying. Bears are waking up earlier because of warmer temperatures, waking up from their hibernation cycles, and they're finding that they don't have enough food to eat because the food phenology of plants and animals hasn't caught up with the changing climate. In 2016, wildfires destroyed a forest the size of the area of Colorado. That was a record. Australia has already identified and documented 6 ecosystem collapses due to climate change, not just coral reefs, which we might have heard of, but also kelp forests, mangroves. Nobody's smiling anymore. Come on, guys, keep me going. California just advised that all coastal development should account for 10 feet of sea level rise. So at least they're paying attention to Mike Tyson. Thank you. What we have to understand and embrace that climate change is here, and it's not going away. This is our future. Even if we achieve the goals of the Paris Agreement, we will stabilize at 1.5 degrees Celsius. That doesn't mean that climate change stops. That means that temperatures stabilize. Climate change lives for a long time beyond that. And we have to understand and embrace this if we are going to build resilience. So what is resilience? Everybody's talking about it from sports, from economics, psychology. What does it mean for conservation and development? Well, if you look back to the definitions way back in 1973, Hollings came up with this definition that focuses on the persistence of systems. I question that. Is that still relevant in the changing climate? Can systems persist in perpetuity? The IPCC, International Panel on Climate Change, came out with a definition in 2012 that focuses on hazardous events. You wouldn't expect that from a climate change science body, focusing on things like hurricanes and forest fires, drought, and recovering from those. But I don't think that goes far enough. It's just not events. U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service defines resilience by focusing on natural systems. And what I think is interesting about here, it's not the ability necessarily of a system to recover naturally, but even with management assistance. And in conservation, we are going to, if we want to allow systems to persist and survive, we're going to need a lot more management assistance for them. The United States International Agency for International Development doesn't look at nature at all. They talk about climate change. Maybe they're not allowed to talk about that. But they talk about people, households, and communities. And what's interesting and new here is they don't talk about just events. They talk about chronic stressors, things you don't recover from, but things that you learn to live with. And finally, the Rockefeller Foundation, which is also very interested in resilience, has added the concept of transformation. It's moving beyond persistence, but allowing systems to reinvent themselves to continue. And then along comes climate change. What does climate change mean in a changing climate? These pictures are from Hurricane Florence. Who knew I would have more recent pictures to talk today? Unfortunately, that's the reality we live with. When we talk about climate change, there's two kinds of climate change I think you need to understand. The first is what I call Godzilla. It's things that are like stronger and more frequent extreme events. Hurricanes, droughts, forest fires. Godzilla comes, Godzilla destroys, you recover from it, and then Godzilla will come back again. What we don't pay attention to enough is what I call the blob. How many people have seen that 1950s B movie? Okay, more than I usually get. So good. The blob is a little more insidious than Godzilla. It is slow moving, almost imperceptible, and therefore we often ignore it when we plan for the future. These are long-term chronic stressors, the things that USAID was talking about. Sea level rise, glacial melt, shifting precipitation patterns. And so at WWF, when we were looking, trying to get our head around what resilience means to us, we looked at the evolution of these of resilience, and we came up with our own definition. The ability of social ecological systems, people and nature living together, absorb and recover from climate change shocks, that's Godzilla, adapting to chronic stressors, that's the blob, and transforming when necessary. So what is your role as environmental educators in building resilience? First, you need to educate yourself. Find out how your communities, your ecosystems, and the species that you're working with are at risk to climate change, and find out what people are doing around the world to help manage those risks. Here's a great podcast I'd recommend if you don't like to read scholarly literature. I do not recommend reading resilience literature. Listen to this podcast, AmericaAdapts.org. It's a great resource. We also at WWF have developed a lot of courses that we've put online in 7 languages. Unless you speak only Italian, there's no reason why you should not be using these. WWFadapt.org. Online, free, simple courses And we also have participatory exercises you can use in your work, free for download. Next, you have to keep doing what you're already good at. This is more important than ever. Connect people with nature. But it takes on an entirely new dimension with climate change. We need to build a constituency for nature because people are adapting to climate change. And what they're doing to protect themselves is going to harm nature many times. We need to prepare for the next generation to prepare to save nature from new threats. Here, China is building a seawall that's threatening the habitat for 25% of the world's migratory birds. Yeah. And finally, you need to reorient education towards the future. Conservation needs to move out of the past. We cannot get ourselves stuck in we're losing nature. Nature is changing. We have to embrace that. EPA is doing this by talking about how wetlands are not only important, but also how they're changing due to climate change. We have to welcome the new nature. And as I looked up yesterday at the exhibit hall, I see a lot of great examples up there of this already happening, and we need a lot more to do of this kind of stuff. So I want to leave you with another quote. The good news is nature is resilient. Nothing's going to kill it, not even people. But we need to understand nature persists, nature is big, not every tree lasts forever, not every stream flows until the end of the time. The world changes and nature changes with it. That is our future. Thank you.
Wow, that's incredible. That's even more incredible. Thank you, Shaun. That is that's beautiful. That's scary. It's like watching the blob. It's chilling. Our next speaker, and if you would switch the slide for me so I don't make a goof of it. There she is, ladies and gentlemen. Our next speaker is Sheila Williams Ridge. She is the director of the Shirley G. Moore Laboratory School at the University of Minnesota. I had a chance to meet her last night. I want to go have a child, so she will take them and educate them. She is lovely. She is passionate about encouraging both adults and children in nature-based play. She has extensive experience in the early childhood education and development. She works as a facilitator for the National Association for the Education of Young People in the Nature Interest Forum. And she is a co-author of a new book that, open up your Amazon and you can pre-order right now. Literally, it is on pre-order now. I don't see phones come out, come on. It is called Nature-Based Learning for Young Children, Anytime, Anywhere, Any Budget. Ladies and gentlemen, Sheila Williams Rich.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you.
Thank you so much for having me here today. I'm super excited to share a little bit about early childhood and what I do. And I wanted to start with my why. This is one of my whys. This is my youngest daughter when she was 3. These are my girls. I live in Minnesota. And Minnesota is another place in the United States that is affected by climate change. My girls play hockey. They play outside in the pond, which is very exciting. And this is why I do what I do. My oldest daughter just graduated from law school and passed the bar earlier this week. Yay! She also has her undergraduate degree in environmental science. So thank you for your work. And she plans to eventually go into environmental law. So early childhood as a force for the future. We have a lot of work to do right now in our world, and I think that keeping our positivity, like my song, thinking about all the wonderful things that there are in the world, I think children bring us back to that center. They remind us why we do what we do and the wonderful things that they have ahead for them if we do our job. So early childhood can also meet a lot of really important goals in our society. One of them is economic development and economic stability. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about that, the opportunity or achievement gap, and conservation, which is most of what we're here for. So high quality early childhood education and K-12 have the promise to really help change our society for the better. It prepares children for the workforce and for citizenship in our world. And 15 years ago, the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis did a study, and they were specifically looking at the investment in early childhood, especially high quality early childhood. And what they found is that for at-risk children, that investment far outweighs the cost. That is really an important place for us to put our dollars and to put our investment. And our early childhood environmental education is a way for us to meet those goals for children, as well as our goals for teaching them environmental stewardship and environmental literacy. So this is one of my favorite quotes. Albert Einstein, a pretty smart guy, also thought about nature. When we're thinking about children's development and how children will progress, we want to think about all the benefits for them, but dually we can think about the benefits for our society. So children growing up and having an increased physical and mental health, social and emotional development, as well as inquiry-related skills. We talked about yesterday, one of our speakers talked about critical thinking skills and how important it is for young children to be able to think about things critically and ask questions. And no one asks questions better than a three-year-old. They're excellent at it. And then cognitive development. I went to a wonderful session yesterday by one of the partners who studied and looked at all the current research on all the cognitive and other forms of development that are supported by nature-based learning. And the research is pouring in. Everyone is working so hard to find out how is this benefiting children and how is it benefiting our world. So another important part is that children gain confidence and they learn courage and they learn those things that are the things that make you so good at your job, that you can sustain and be optimistic and help you see the larger picture in our world. So this is one of my favorite quotes by Rachel Carson. I don't know if you have ever read A Sense of Wonder. If you haven't, you should. But it really is about connecting at that deeper level. We all learn things when we take children into nature. The children are learning things, context, and important skills. But it is more important that they are feeling that connection, that when they grow up and have their jobs in all sorts of fields, they might be an investment banker at the Federal Reserve. They could work at a local hospital and make decisions about waste and recycling. They might work at a school or at the dentist. And anywhere they go, they will have that deeper connection with nature that will help them make better decisions that will impact us all. So I wanted to share a few photos because I get to take a lot of photos of young children and think about those goals that we have for children, both the conservation side and also the child development side. So this photo, the children are able to think critically about what they're seeing. They're learning observation skills. They are, you know, playing with each other. They're experiencing joy in nature. They're having a chance to make that deeper connection and ask important questions. I work with young children between 2 and 5, but I also work with college students and teaching them to see the role that children have in observation and in really connecting children, especially children and animals, is a wonderful thing. And also giving them chances to try something that they might not. This little girl, her name is also, oops, I went too far. This little girl, her name is also Olivia, really bonded with the snakes very early on. And I always joke with the families that I give them a gift when their children come to my school that none of their children will ever be afraid of snakes because we have them all over our school. But we do also talk to them about these are snakes that are safe. And if you're ever outside, you should ask your grown-ups. Which ones are. And so she's learning things, other children are learning things about risk and resiliency and the things that they need to overcome, and that comes with knowledge. So giving children opportunities to play and gain knowledge and take risks. How high can I jump? How deep are those leaves? How deep is that water? What can I do to explore? And having that adult with you, that adult that can really scaffold your learning and take you through, answer your questions. And when you ask that really great why question when a child asks you, that you don't just give them the answer, but that you encourage them to explore, ask deeper questions, and find out what they really want to know about, because that's how children will find their passion, and hopefully they're able to find it in places outdoors. This is one of my favorite old photos from my classroom. These girls gathered feathers, and they're running because they hope that it will help them fly. And you don't discourage that kind of thing. In young children, you encourage the play, you encourage the creativity, you encourage them to communicate with each other and share their ideas, and let's see, how does this work? Will this work? Maybe I need more feathers. You should have seen later in the day. Oh, man. So letting them really experience things. Some of these are pretty fun because we really give them a chance in early childhood environmental education forums and nature-based preschools. I'm going to talk about them in just a few minutes, but that children are allowed to really, really try and try deeply and try with their whole bodies. The photo after this one did not look that great because my camera was covered in mud, but it was wonderful. And the learning opportunities. Wherever you are in the world, children will have chances to try things, to work together. And we really want to give them opportunities, no matter where they are, to be outside every day. I also wanted to just touch on a little bit more about mental health and children and having those times to slow down. And so many times in our educational environments, children are encouraged to kind of get things done and let's move on to the next thing and we have to have snack and we have to go outside and the bus is going to be here to pick you up and here are the other things that you do. And nature really gives children an opportunity to slow down and to feel and to experience. And that is incredibly important for their development and for their mental health. We also give children opportunities to fail and opportunities to try things that might not work out. In case you haven't noticed, this is not the way that you should hold that tool. And the other way would work much better, but we can give them suggestions and we can have a dialogue about it. But chances to fail are important for all of us because children learning to get through things that don't work is so important for all of us to learn and to be able to recover from those things. So, and also trying things that might work. That snow shovel is probably not gonna dig in the dirt as much as those other ones, but opportunities to try these things over and over again. And appropriate risk, that's something that's in the book. You talk about that a little bit. And also the Natural Start Alliance through NAAEE is coming out with some guidelines that also talk about risk and how to have appropriate risk in programs like these. And, you know, rolling a log, there are some dangers that could happen, but there's obviously several teachers nearby. I'm there with a camera, there's another teacher on the other side. We're giving children opportunities to try things give them a chance to fail, but also to be safe. So, a few more pictures, I have to stop soon. Also, more animals in the environment. I brought too many pictures, but I really wanted to give you a chance to see some of the growth. Some of you have seen this slide already. It's important that we are educating each other about best practices and what we can do with early childhood nature-based programs. They're growing all over the world. And there's definitely one in your backyard. So you should look on the Natural Start Alliance website. It's at naturalstart.org. Because everywhere around the country, these programs are showing up. And children are having an opportunity to have wonderful experiences in nature. Whether you're in Minnesota or in Hawaii, that's where these two pictures are of my two youngest daughters. That children are, or if it is a crack in the street. By the way, we stayed here for about 20 minutes looking at these ants. So I'm just going to end on a quote by Rachel Carson. This is one of my favorites. Thank you.
I want her to teach me. Our last speaker for this, can you do it for me? Thank you, there it is. Great, this is Kevin Chang. He is the executive director of Kua'āina Ulu Auamo. Not bad. It is a nonprofit organization with the mission to increase the capacity of community resource management initiatives with a vision towards Aina Momona, which is rich land. And as you will, when you talk with him, it's also rich seas, which I think is a very important thing. Kua advances mission through facilitation of grassroots community-driven learning networks. And this is important. It also serves as a liaison to assist in the development of equitable collaborations between communities, agencies, and larger conservation initiatives. Kevin, at one time, practiced law, and we won't hold that against him. But he also is the member of a very rockin' band called Kua'āina. And my assistant and I were rocking out to it in my office just 2 days ago. So it's really good. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Kevin Chang.
Eala e elupu, kealali uho akalani, kihei aku I kahalawai he. Hu, kaumai I ka auamo, ali I kumakua, maka ka puni ka umeke pohe pohe. Ka eo ana, ka eo la, koko velu velu pahono ia, ua pa e. Ua pa'ala, ave ave pu alu e alu pu, ki ilili ku oloku. I just did the, thank you. This is the earlier chant of a network called E Alu Pu, the community of rural and native Hawaiian communities across the state of Hawaii, who actually created the work that I do. They created my job. They called my organization into existence. The name of our organization is Kua'āina Ulu Auamo, and I propose to you that that is the future. Kua'āina means grassroots, ulu means to grow, and Auamo is a carrying stick. It's a carrying stick that we all carry on our shoulders together when an issue is complex and requires us to work together. And so I agree with Jane that the future is about collaboration. The chat says, are we ready? And it says, we are ready to move forward. And then in writing this chat, we asked one of our elders, where does your obligations end? Where are your responsibilities? What is your kuleana? Kuleana is a Hawaiian word that means right, privilege, and responsibility. That rights and responsibilities are entwined and belong together and cannot be separated the way that we do today. And he said, my responsibility is to the horizon, and I can't see beyond it. I can't see where it ends. And then the chat goes on to say that this thing we carry is a long tradition from these islands that have been here since time immemorial. And in carrying this awamo, this stick or this palanquin on our shoulders together, we lift it up. It's made of the wood, the hard woods, native woods of our mountains. And on that we hang the water gourd. It's cracked right now. That water gourd is cracked and is held in a net, which is falling apart. But when we can get together, we can start to remend that net, which is our community, and put the water back in the gourd, and we can stand together. And at the end of this ole, this chant, says, are we ready? And we stand ready. K Ki-li-li, ku-olo-ku. These are the words of the ancestors. And when we talk about ancestors, the people I work for, they're talking about birds, and they're talking about the land, and they're talking about the waters that flow through their mountains. So my name is Kevin Chang. I am Chinese-Irish, born and raised in Hawaii, on a peripheral state 2,500 miles away from anywhere else in the world. I grew up in a confluence of cultures. And I learned that word because yesterday, and I want to recommend to you, if you get anything from what I say now, go upstairs to see the Palus Prairie Charter School poster. Yesterday I saw maybe 20 kids and their teacher, and it looks like they came here on a little kind of field trip, taking a picture of themselves in front of their poster. But go read that poster. It talks about a confluence of cultures and how these kids dove into it and learned about building a canoe as a way of learning about their place and the cultures and the people of their place. Because I agree with Jane that the future is collaborative. With Shaun, is it, we have to learn how to adapt. But also the future is local. The future is restorative justice. It is intergenerational. And it is value-driven. And I heard another word the other day. Maybe some of you are saying it. Like I know that in the food movement, they say food deserts. And I heard the word civic deserts. The future is about civic oases. The word we use in our community to talk about connecting communities of strong culture, we use the word kipuka. Kipuka is a Hawaiian word that talks about basically when the volcano erupts and it covers the plains, there are little pukas or holes in that flow, and as it dries, those holes become green again. And then they sprout the ohialehua, the native trees of our lands, come back out of the lava flows. And I propose that each of you are an oasis. Just like our rural Native Hawaiian communities across Hawaii are cultural oases who are reviving a tradition of community-based management in our community. That is that people have always been a part of managing and caring for our resources. So that's the word, kipuka, oases. Each of you are an oasis, and think of how you can grow the potential of your community and your place through environmental education and through civic education. Another word, maybe a takeaway word that I used earlier is kuleana, that rights and responsibilities are entwined. Another word, I'm kind of just, winging it here. Another thought that our communities in Hawaii, that by the way, these are our communities. I'm just letting it roll so you can see the many people who are doing this work. We talk about a konohiki mindset. Konohiki was the title of a person less than 100 years ago, who was either a lower chief or a person appointed by a chief of an area. But that person was sort of like, today we equivalent it to a land manager. But if you took the word konohiki, kono means to entice or to encourage, and hiki is to do. This person sat between government and the people and help to create a place for governance. So the konohiki built bridges, and that's what you can do with your oases too, is build bridges. If you build from a small place, so our view is if we connect communities of strong cultural values and practice, they will no longer feel alone. When they no longer feel alone, they realize they're part of a larger movement, and we help them build that movement. And you can do that from your oases. Last term, since it looks like I'm running out of timer, is Mālama'aina. Malama means to care, but it means active stewardship and caring. Aina means that which feeds. It's a term used to describe the mountains and the oceans. Aina, that which feeds. Not just land, but that which feeds. A recent court case in Hawaii regarding military training came out with a kind of ruling in which one of our courts used the term malama aina to describe what many of you may know or should know as the public trust doctrine, that the environment does not belong to us and that we need to take care of it now for the future. So public trust doctrine, think about that for the future too. Since I'm out of time here. Last thing I want to leave you with is the motto for the state of Hawaii is a phrase, Uamau ke'ea o ka'aina I ka pono. The song that was playing when I came up was a song by the former secretary of my board called Uamau. Uamau means to persist. Uamau ke'ea. Ea means life. It means breath. But it also means governance. Because our communities are stepping into those spaces when our government is absent and there's a need for governance. And that's why the future is local and that you can do the same where you're at. Uamau ke'ea o ka'aina I ka pono. Pono meaning righteousness. So uamau ke'ea o ka'aina I ka pono means the life of the land is perpetuated or governed in righteousness. And so this song I'm going to sing for you is from 1978. When our state embedded the malama aina, or the public trust doctrine, into the constitution of our state. And the phrase harkens back and was a phrase said by King Kamehameha III at a time when the governance of Hawaii was in question, when the government of Britain had for a short period taken over. And when the life of governance to the Hawaiian nation was restored, he said, Uamau ke'ea o ka'aina I ka pono. And now that is the motto for our state. So in listening to this, think of, many of you may not know, but Hawaii is the only state with a palace. The only state that was a nation of its own. Think of the people who are of that nation.
Would they cry for the land that was taken away. Still yet you fight Hawaii. Uamo, Keo Kaina, Ikapono, Hano, Hano Hawaii. Oh, the giving that the queen had done, she gave her aloha to everyone. Now, how would she feel if she saw Hawaii today? Oh, the fighting that the king had done to unite the islands, now there's condominiums. Now, how would he feel about this modern city life? Tears would come from each other's eyes as they would start to realize that our land is in great, great danger now. Would they feel? Would they smile, be content, and then cry? Cry for the gods and cry for the people. Cry for the land that was taken away. And still yet you fight Hawaii. Uamau, Keo Kaina, Ikapono, Hano, Hano Hawaii. Uamau, Keo Kaina, Ikapono, Hano, Hano Hawaii. Uamau, Keo Kaina, Ikapono, Hano, Hano Hawaii.
Mahalo.
It's a great handoff. It's back to art. Environment and art and working together, I think we can make a big difference. From building conservation operations that are networking to build scale and sharing environmental literacy with our youth, understanding the imminent impacts of climate change and how we have to address them, and then building support within the community, ownership within groups. I think these are all themes that, as storytellers, we need to support. And I make a commitment that that's what I'll do. I've got a couple of pieces that I just want to show you. We're going to do it fast because we're running out of time here. This piece actually ties in, I think, beautifully to all the themes that were discussed today within this structure. It evolved from a film that we did at Disney Animation, my first studio, as I like to call it. We did a film called Moana about a year and a half ago. And out of that, an amazing amount of just incredible collaborations evolved. And I'm really proud of the film and the work that we were able to do together with Conservation International, with the Disney Conservation Fund, and also a lot of local leadership from the island of Samoa, a sister island. Let's see if I can bring it up here. I think it's a right side up. Very good. Here goes.
movie Moana has inspired traditional voyaging for me. I love the ocean.
Everything in that movie connects with our culture.
We're taking the movie Moana around Samoa to deliver this very powerful message. We were voyagers. We were caretakers of our land. Samoana Fulang. This translates to sacred ocean voyage.
We see this sacred ocean voyage as a stand to help our communities realize what's at stake. The immediate threats the Pacific Ocean is facing is pollution, habitat destruction and overfishing, and climate change.
If we do not take care of the ocean would definitely not give us what we need. Moana has inspired me to care for the ocean. In the movie, the ocean is our protector and friend.
Our communities here on the ground, they're the front line if we are going to sustain our resources. The main message that this movie and this voyage is about is reconnecting to your past, seeing where you come from, knowing that your responsibility is being an environmental steward.
We're teaching culture, we're teaching navigation, we're teaching environment.
Of this workshop, we then screen the movie Moana. It gives us something to be proud of. And when then there's pride, there can be change.
I am very proud that my Polynesian culture is being shared with the world for the movie Moana. And I would love to be that Moana for our Samoan island as well.
The response, the level of energy has been awe-inspiring.
I would like to say to all the young generation of Samoa, protect our environment and our ocean because that is the key to our future.
A shameless plug. So yeah, that's great. That's where I think media should be in the future. They should be supporting initiatives like this, and that's what we want to do. We're running out of time. I have two pieces of video that I want to show you, and I'm going to ram through them right now. They're very short. It comes back to storytelling and how you can use storytelling. The next Disney, well, first of all, we are celebrating 10 years right now. And the great thing over the last 10 years is with every film we've worked with a great nonprofit to help sustain some sort of conservation effort, World Wildlife Before, Jane Goodall Institute, other things like that. It's been great, and I'm so proud of it. We have coming up a film called Penguins. If you want to, I think if you go to the booth, you actually can see these clips that I'm going to give. These are two trailers that we did, and it kind of shows you how storytelling can alter. We're using essentially the same imagery between the two. The first one, and I'm going to just bop through there and then bring Judy back up, and then if you want to speak with us after, we'll be down here because we're running out of time. The first piece really shows kind of, it goes towards the adventure of the piece. And then the second piece, and this is where I think media can do a great job too, is it speaks to the humor and to the heart. And oftentimes with humor and heart, you can actually talk about very serious issues and open up minds that might have been closed otherwise. So that's, I think, the contribution that we can make. So I'm going to just run these back to back, and you can see adventure, humor.
Antarctica is one of the most remote and treacherous landscapes on the planet.
We're having winds of 80, 90 miles an hour, storms that we couldn't even stand up in.
Antarctica is always good for surprises and uncomfortable conditions.
Disneynature has gathered a remarkable team to film in unimaginable conditions, bringing audiences a never-before-seen adventure.
You think of Antarctica, it's the emperors that are the celebrities around here. But the first time we saw one Adélie penguin just wander through the entire emperor colony like he owned the place.
At that moment, the team knew they had their star. Meet Steve.
He's this hyperactive, caffeinated little bundle of energy. He's like no other penguin.
We follow Steve as he navigates the challenges of parenthood for the first time, making every possible mistake along the way. And using new technology, we're able to show these penguins in a way they've never been seen before. Come join Disneynature on this incredible adventure to see a world few have ever experienced until now. Disneynature's Penguins.
And really, the filmmakers, those guys out in the field, they're the heroes. Now here's the humor one.
Antarctica. Home to the deadly leopard seal. The mighty killer whale. And Steve.
Thunder, feel the thunder. Thunder, feel the thunder.
A gentleman who stands out from the crowd.
Thunder, feel the thunder.
He's looking for love.
Just a young girl with a quick view.
He likes long walks on the beach.
I was dreaming.
Fishing. And collecting rocks.
Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star.
Lucky for him, he's found his match. But when his other half leaves him alone with the kids, he discovers that being a father is more than he bargained for. Next Earth Day, Disneynature invites you to join an extraordinary couple fighting to raise a family in one of the most unforgiving and stunning places on Earth. Disney Nature's Penguins, Earth Day 2019.
Thank you, guys. Judy, thank you, speakers.
You guys are great.